Hello. I'm back at the library again, and I've found an article that I'd like to read. I found this I was told about this article by one of my acquaintances in the virtual reality community. I spend a lot of time in VR these days, and so it's one of my interests, and there was this article about simulating virtual out-of-body experiences. For those of you who may not know, an out-of-body experience is a perceptual experience that some people have where they seem to perceive themselves rising out of their body and being in whatever place they're at in a disembodied state, and as will be elaborated in the article, it sometimes is correlated with changes in perspective about consciousness and where consciousness is localized and what death means, that sort of thing. So the abstract basically explains that they did an experiment with 16 participants in a study, and experimented with different viewpoints. So at the beginning here, we'll start there. A near-death experience, NDE, is an altered state of consciousness that can occur during clinical death, typically following cardiac arrest. Characteristics of NDEs can vary widely, but generally include the perception of moving through a tunnel, bright lights, meeting spiritual beings, panoramic life review, euphoria, and an out-of-body experience. Parnia, Waller, et al. Reported that 11% of cardiac arrest survivors experienced an NDE. Van Lommel, Van Wees reported 18%, and Klemek-Ketis reported 19%. Generally, patients exhibit a change in life outlook following such an event, becoming more concerned about others, becoming more generous and charitable, and so on. Van Lommel, Van Wees found that this may take several years to consolidate, and indeed lasts several years after the event. In this paper, we concentrate only on the OBE, out-of-body experience, aspect of an NDE. Blink Landis defined an OBE as the experience in which a person seems to be awake and to see his body and the world from a location outside the physical body. In fact, OBEs are considered to be one of the key phenomenological characteristics of NDEs, and it has been found that people experiencing NDEs showed reduced fear of death and enhanced belief in life after death. The goal of the experiment, reported in this paper, is to examine whether an experience of the center of perception of people being located outside their body might influence their fear of death. Metzinger argued that the experience of OBEs may be the origin of the idea that the soul, i.e. survival after death. Our idea was that if we could put people in a situation illustrating the possibility of their consciousness being outside of their body, then this would provide implicit evidence, but not necessarily explicit belief, that survival beyond the body is possible, and hence produce a reduction in fear of death. I'm going to take a second to try to parse that sentence. Okay, so if we put people in a situation, the situation illustrates the possibility of the consciousness being outside of the body. then this would provide implicit evidence that survival beyond the body is possible, and hence produce a reduction in fear of death. This, like putting people in a situation, is what the this refers to. So I think what they're saying here is they're trying to provide evidence to the people in the situation. So they're not providing evidence to science, but they're providing evidence to people that survival beyond the body is possible, and experiencing that evidence would reduce their fear of death. That's interesting. It's an interesting way to say that. Let's continue. We used immersive virtual reality in order to accomplish this, and in particular, the method of virtual embodiment. A person wearing a wide field of view, head-tracked stereo, head-mounted display can look in any direction within the virtual environment. In particular, they can look towards their real body, and if the system has been so programmed, they would see a life-sized virtual body visually substituting their own. Similarly, they can see a reflection of the body in a virtual mirror, and also shadows. With real-time motion capture, the virtual body can be programmed to move synchronously with the person's real body movements. Moreover, if something is seen to touch the virtual body, the setup can include vibrotactile stimulation on the person's real body, synchronous with the seen touch. Such multisensory stimulation typically leads to the perceptual illusion in people that the virtual body is their own, even though they know that this is not the case. This was referred to as a full body ownership illusion, or just body ownership illusion. The idea is derived from the rubber hand illusion first presented by Botvinnik and Cohen, where a rubber hand is placed on a table in front of a person and seen to be tapped and stroked synchronously with corresponding stimulation on their out-of-sight real hand. We refer to this as synchronous visual tactile stimulation. This results in an illusion of ownership over the rubber hand, with physiological and brain activation anxiety responses when the rubber hand is attacked. When the stimulation is asynchronous, the illusion does not occur. That's something I find interesting, and I think it's good that they utilize that. Synchronicity has pretty radical perceptual effect on our mind. It can stimulate perceptual illusions extremely effectively. And I mean, I guess that's probably known to the field of psychological science. Let's see, they did the same thing with a mannequin body and anxiety responses then if the mannequin body was attacked, and that this experience can be reproduced in virtual reality where they use a virtual arm and hand instead of a rubber hand. When I'm in virtual reality, I don't have any sort of setup that gives me visual tactile stimulation, but I do experience a pretty intense feeling of identification with my virtual body when I'm in that virtual space. I look down and I see my hands and the rest of my body, and my mind immediately starts to correlate it with my own, to think of it as an extension of my physical self, pretty intuitively. which I think is something that you'd expect. The overall strategy we used was to first embody participants in a virtual body. In order to induce a strong body ownership illusion, the virtual body was seen in 1 PP and approximately spatially coincident with the real body and seen from the position of the eyes of the virtual body. Not sure what 1 PP is. Oh, here we go. One person, first person perspective. Like a first person shooter, for instance, is in 1 PP. The virtual body was seen in first-person perspective and spatially coincident with the real body, so in the real place that the actual physical body was. The body was in a reclining position on a comfortable chair located in a virtual room. There was synchronous visual motor correlation between real and virtual body movements, and visual tactile synchronous correlation between virtual balls seemed to be striking the body and vibro-tactile stimulation on the corresponding body part. So, what it's saying here is when the real body moved, the virtual body moved, and when the virtual body was struck, the real body was struck. The setup is shown in figure one. Oh, no, it's figure one. Okay, so here is what the setup was like. So here is a physical person sitting in a chair. Their legs are up on this table. And then this is what, so that's A. C here is what this person is seeing in the virtual space. They're seeing a virtual room, they're seeing virtual legs, and they're seeing their hands. And then these are just different shots from that first person's perspective in the virtual space. These are not color photos, so it's probably easier to see. It's the description says that the images show the balls, the virtual balls striking the virtual body. But when the participant, and it also describes how when the participant moves their hands or moves their feet, the virtual body's hands and feet move. Okay, so that was they called this the in-body phase. Oh, we're still on this one. Okay, they called that the in-the-body phase. After a maximum of 11 minutes of being in the body phase, the participants experienced an out-of-body phase. Erson induced the illusion of being out-of-body, where participants saw their real body sitting in front of where their viewpoint was located. This was achieved by, so this is another researcher. This was achieved by participants wearing a stereo HMD, to which video was streamed from a pair of cameras behind them. Okay, so this researcher here, instead of using a virtual space, he used actual cameras from where the participant was actually located. And the cameras were streaming video to the virtual reality headset. And then the cameras moved to view the participant from behind, at which point the experimenter tapped their chest while synchronously striking under the camera with a stick. So from the viewpoint of participants, it seemed as if the stick striking the camera was causing the feeling on their chest. The effect of this was to move their sense of perception behind where they saw their real body to be, resulting in an out-of-body illusion where their real body was disowned, considered as an empty shell. Cool. In the version that we used in this experiment, After the initial embodiment phase, the viewpoint of participants moved up to the ceiling and behind the virtual body. The virtual balls continued to strike the space around their visual center of perception, i.e. where their body would have been. Correspondingly, they felt the vibrotactile synchronous stimulation. If they moved their real body, the virtual body below remained stationary. So the visual and visual tactile sensations shifted to the location near the ceiling. We refer to this as the OBE condition. So when the person moved their body or their body was struck by an object, they no longer spatially associated it with their physical body or the virtual body that they were seeing in the virtual space. We refer to this as the OBE condition. The goal in this condition was that participants would feel out of their body, the body in which they'd previously been embodied with a high level of body ownership. Although in our method, participants were shifted behind and upwards, compared to Arison, where they were shifted only behind, it has been shown that this makes no difference. And from what I've heard, from what I've read of other out-of-body experiences, floating up to the ceiling is extremely common in that experience. They used a control condition, which was another method, almost the same as above, with participants seeing their body from behind, but seeing it tapped on the back while they feel the synchronously on their actual back. In this case, perception is split between a visual point of view that is behind the real body, but also visual capture of the tapping seen on the back of the body in front. It's to the feeling that the tactile sensation is located at the body in front. So while participants may feel out of their body, they also have the sensation of being drawn towards the body in front, which manifests itself in a measurable drift in their estimated own body location towards the body in front. They did a figure of this one, 2A, so better look at that one because I have a hard time grasping that one. Let's see.
Just so you know where the white fiction is, it's right.
Okay, so here's the two out-of-body experience phases. This first one was their control condition where as you can see, the camera or the visual perspective has moved up and above virtual body, but when the virtual objects continue to strike the body, they still feel it in their physical body. And then this was the other out-of-body condition, where the balls are up here. It's hard to see. This is a two-dimensional picture, but the balls are up near the ceiling with the person's viewpoint and striking them there. So it's separating them from the perception, from the ownership of this virtual body entirely. Okay, whereas in the method of Arison, participants feel that they are out of their body with disownership of the body in the front. The method of Langenhager and Toddy, and other researchers, results in a feeling of ownership over the body in front. We will call this method drifting body experience. And that's, I think, they're describing this one here. Langenhager, Mouthon carried out a study using both paradigms. With the participant's viewpoint always raised above the surrogate body, and confirmed that OBE resulted in disownership of the surrogate body. Whereas DBE, drifting body experience, resulted in ownership. Okay, so here they're just describing the difference of between these two types again, where they still feel ownership of the body if they feel what it appears to experience, and they lose ownership of the body after. enter, their sensations and perceptions no longer correspond with what's happening to the virtual body. Our experiment used a between groups design. They had 16 participants in each group, in drifting body and out of body. One group experienced body ownership while in the virtual body, as described above, and then experienced the OBE condition. In the other group, the same in-body phase followed by the drifting body experience condition. The second phase lasted for 1 minute, 23 seconds in both conditions, and involved seeing their virtual body from above. Both groups consisted of women students recruited from the Faculty of Psychology at the UB campus, with ages from about 18 to 24. The groups were almost identical with respect to religious conviction and self-esteem. And then the study was approved. They gave written informed consent. They got course credit. Okay, so results. So they were given a questionnaire after they experienced this out-of-body simulation. Two questions investigating body ownership were asked after the initial in-body phase by reading them out to the participants and recording their score. Answers were on a Likert scale, ranging from 1 to 7, with a value of 1 meaning they did not feel that at all, and a value of 7 meaning they felt it in its maximum intensity. So here are the questions. Please indicate to what extent you felt each of the sensations that I will indicate now. My body, I felt as if the body I was seeing was my own body. Other body, I felt as if the body I was seeing belonged to someone else. So just asking how people are experiencing this virtual scenario. To evaluate the spatial self-location of participants, we adapted the mental ball dropping task of this other study, asking participants to imagine how long it would take for an imaginary apple drop from their hand to the floor. So that time estimation, time and physics estimation in order to determine what they experienced of spatial self-location. And then at the conclusion of the virtual reality exposure, they were asked to complete a subscale death of self of the Collett-Lester fear of death scale, designed to measure fear of death. I didn't even know someone had made a scale like that. Alright, so then they talked about their statistical model a little bit, which I admit that I'm not terribly familiar with statistical models. Here are the questions involved with the fear of death. So, what level of worry or anxiety do you have for the following aspects related to your own death? And the options here are isolation of death, the shortness of life, missing out on so much after you die, dying young, how it will feel to be dead, never thinking or experiencing anything again, the disintegration of your body after you die. Some statistical analysis box plots of the body ownership questionnaires. The thick black horizontal lines are medians, the boxes are the interquartile ranges, and the whiskers extend from the minimum value to the maximum value. So talking about this, they say box plots of the responses to these questions are shown for each condition. The overall response to the my body identification is high. 50% of participants gave a score of 6 or more, with at least 75% giving a score of 5 or more. The scores for other body are much lower. And then we're talking about statistical extrapolations and analysis. So those in the drifting body condition, that was the control condition, tended to affirm body ownership, but those who experienced the out-of-body experience condition tended to disown the virtual body. Here's another graph, which is the posterior probability distributions of the expected values of other body and my body. So that's the expected value of questionnaire score, probability density. And then it talks about the spatial analysis of the spatial perception that they did regarding the ball dropping or apple dropping task. And then they have each element of death or fear of death changes. So there's very strong evidence that all of these fears of death, you know, fear of the solitude and dying young, I'm not sure exactly which of these variables are which. I guess I didn't even notice this. They assign variables to each trait, I guess as just a shorthand, but it's this is how you'd name a variable in computer programming, for instance. So that's interesting. So all these variable names, they correspond with these longer explanations. It shows the answers of the people who experience the out-of-body experience and those who experience the drifting body experience and how they were different. So there's strong evidence that they fear solitudeless. Section, they talk about the fear of death experiences before and after the experiment and how religious beliefs played into it. Basically, they discuss how it didn't actually seem to affect the change in the fear of death. And then they move on to the discussion. They say, the embodiment of participants with characteristics that are different from their own bodies can have perceptual and cognitive effects. They've done previous experiments with different skin colors and that sort of thing, and they've also done experiments with anxiety and so forth. Let's see, they talk about how they are able to induce body ownership of the embodied phase, the virtual body. And what's new about their experiment is they showed that in the out-of-body experience condition, the overall fear of death is lower than in the drifting body experience condition. Out-of-body experiences are usually reported in the context of near-death experiences, but they also occur spontaneously. There is not a lot of previous work on the life consequences of out-of-body experiences that occur independently of NDEs. However, in a survey of 339 respondents to a questionnaire about out-of-body experiences, some researchers reported that sometime after their experience, 84% wanted to have the experience again, 81% felt the experience was very pleasant, and 71% said that it was of lasting benefit. Most importantly for our discussion, 63% reported that it enhanced their belief towards life after death, compared to 32% of a control group, 81 people who were interested in out-of-body experiences but had never experienced one. Our results are consistent with such empirical findings as there are, that people who have had spontaneous out-of-body experiences, not necessarily in the context of a near-death experience, are also likely to have reduced death anxiety. Metzinger argued that an out-of-body experience is like a globalized phantom limb experience, where there are two bodies, the physical body, seen from the outside, and a more ethereal body, the phantom. In an out-of-body experience, this ethereal body is perceived as being spatially located outside of the physical body. If this ethereal body is conflated with the idea of soul, then this provides folk phenomenological evidence that indeed the self can exist outside of the physical body, that this constitutes the soul, and that therefore, we would add, there is the possibility of survival beyond physical death. Since in this view, conscious existence may not depend on the physical body. Okay, I'm gonna look at this just a second. Okay, if this ethereal body is conflated with the soul. So basically they're saying if the ethereal body and the soul are indeed the same thing, then that means that the soul can have experiences and be conscious outside of the body. Like, it doesn't have to reside within a physical form, which allows for the possibility of survival beyond physical death. I mean, that's a pretty big if, though, you know, that the ethereal body that's generated in an out-of-body experience is the human soul. That's a big if, and I think that if, I mean, that's going to be a difficult thing to study, but also an extremely interesting thing to study. There's a lot we don't know about perception, about the way consciousness works, about the way our minds work, about how our interpretations of reality work. In virtual reality, we've been talking a lot about lots of speculative ideas, like whether real life is a simulation, you know, like the Matrix or something like that. And we've brought up the idea that we all live in a simulation of reality. It's the reality that our brains simulate. So our brains are constantly generating this simulation of reality that we interpret as reality and interact in. And as far as the technical details of that, like using analogies here, like the format of these things, the format of an experience of reality, the format of perception about how these experiences are generated, we don't have a lot of information. We have information about what happens in the brain when different things happen. Synchronistically, right? So, like, these brain waves are generated when this happens, and these brain waves are generated when this happens, but that does very, very little to actually answer the questions of how it occurs, the technical details of how perception itself is generated, how subjective experience actually works. So, that being the case, this almost untouchably mysterious if is a cool thing to ask questions about, and I think it's really great that scientists are out there looking at it. and using new technology to do so. We often find that new technologies help us further understand ourselves. For instance, DNA, you know, how genetics work, and DNA was discovered at around the same time that computer science was being developed. And certainly understanding of programmatic patterns and algorithms definitely lends itself to help us understand how genetics work, how the DNA programming language works, and helps us conceptually create a more unified view of reality and our own biology and our own selves. But, you know, that unified view is itself simply an aspect of our brain's simulation of reality as well. So this stuff goes deep, and I like it a lot. Let's see. The virtual reality experience provides an experiential but implicit learning of this possibility. This is the second time they've used the word implicit here. I think it kind of refers to the subjective experience of something happening. So nobody's telling you that something happens, but you experience it on your own. It's implicit information. It's not conveyed symbolically. It's conveyed experientially. Basically, giving them the experience of the possibility of consciousness existing outside of the body, but not necessarily, they wouldn't necessarily believe this. Here, by consciousness, we refer to the center of perceptual consciousness, that is, the location at which we are aware of perceiving multisensory information that locates us in space. It's good that they define that. I love definitions, so we don't get confused. In our out-of-body experience condition, visual and visual-tactile integration were located out of the previously owned virtual body, and in the drifting body experience condition, there is still sensory data that appears to be centered on the virtual body. So, just reiterating that again. In the experiment, participants did not know prior that the study was in any way related to death anxiety. Our results open up the possibility that the virtual out-of-body experience provides an implicit learning that consciousness, in the sense of the center of perception, can be separate from the physical body. And therefore, death of the physical body is not necessarily the end of consciousness. What I find interesting here is that they're basically trying to evoke a logical conclusion in their participant by basically a cognitive change in their participant by providing them with very indirect information. So, on the one hand, our participant here has an idea that the body is connected to consciousness. And so they have this belief, right? And this belief directly generates fear of death. In regard to all of those variables that were mentioned previously. So they have this belief, and the researchers basically give them sensory input of an experience that essentially destabilizes or destructuralizes this belief just a little bit, just enough to give them the idea, essentially, that maybe body and consciousness aren't linked. It separates them just a little bit using imagination, using the virtual space. So it separates that just a little bit, and their hypothesis was that destructuring this belief would lead to destructuring the fear just a little bit as well, making it maybe just a little bit smaller. And from their results indicate that they were correct, that this is what happened and this is how it worked. What I find interesting about that is that they're not just studying embodiment in that case. They're not just studying perceptual illusion. They're also indirectly studying the structure of cognition and logic and beliefs and the relationship of all of these different structures, mental structures, and how they interact with each other. There is a lot here. I'm glad I picked this up. This is great to look at. Okay, and then near the end here, they talk about some of their methods, so where they recruited their participants and how they designed the virtual environment using Unity, which I'm learning how to use as well. Yeah, lots of details about where the content came from. How the tactile stimulation was administered, and all the technical details of what the viewpoint saw and how it was all conducted, just more and more details. So that's this article, and I hope you found it as interesting as I did. If you'd like to read it for yourself, here's the information. It's called A Virtual Out-of-Body Experience Reduces Fear of Death. The researchers are these people. Some of them, I'm not going to try to pronounce their names, but here they are. And this article is available for free online. So if you're interested in analyzing it further, I recommend looking it up. There are actually quite a bit of, they're slowly building a body of scientific information using virtual reality as the experimental medium or platform. And I keep seeing more and more of them popping up, and I love it. I think it's a great avenue for scientific inquiry. So if you have interest in VR, I just recommend doing a search on what's out there and what's being studied. And yeah, please let me know if you have any questions or comments or discussions you'd like to engage in. Thanks for joining me, and talk to you later.